mechanical recovery system. Our goal was to, in this school year, build and test a flight-ready, purely electromechanical two-parachute recovery system. And we pretty much accomplished that. We got all the way through to doing a proof of concept where we actually have the whole system set up, which we'll do for you later. And, you know, we press go and the thing goes and it does it what it should. But we haven't done the amount of extensive ground testing nor helicopter tests that we want to do before launch if possible. So our final system is this guy in the middle. I don't know how well you can really see it. So obvious, we're looking inside the nose cone and then our sort of mini aluminum module underneath, and we've got the cup for the drogue parachute and the cup for the main parachute, and then the surgical tubing assembly that goes over the top of the two cups, and that is what initially like ejects the nose cone off when it's released. And so then you can see all of our electronics, more zoomed in here, are all going to be down in what we call the keeper ring or kepper ring. And then this is the drogue parachute release. So again, the recovery system is a two parachute recovery system. And what that ultimately means is that we design two systems or two subsystems that make up the recovery system. And so the first one is the nose cone separation. And that's the most important because the drogue parachute deploys then. And as long as you have your drogue out, you don't completely die, right? But ideally, the main also comes out, which is that second system, this drogue parachute release. And you can kind of see here that it's attached to the cup that houses the main parachute. So when the drogue flies away, it pulls that main cup off and deploys the main. I'd say everything of the system, and this actually is a really neat drawing that you can see, like here it is separated. And yeah, so that's a good overview, I'd say. And here you can kind of see the different parts of our system. So it's mostly aluminum, and then there's a Delrin super hard plastic twist coupling, and was the pinion gear made out of the same material?
Yes.
Okay, so also a pinion gear that couples with the twist coupling. And those are both out of Delrin. So there's the kepper ring, bottom ring, upper ring, and then that twist coupling. And what you're not seeing is inside the motor with the pinion gear that twists that coupling.
Go over that one more time, sorry, starting from the top down.
Yeah, so we've got, this is the ring that would attach to the nose cone.
And that's called the upper ring.
The upper ring, yes. And then you have the twist coupling,
okay,
which sits inside both of those. And as you can probably kind of intuitively see that it's holding both of those together until it's actuated. And you can barely see it here, but when we take apart the system later, you can really tell that there's these little nubs inside that ride in channels within this coupling. And so you put it together, twist it to lock it into place, and then you take your motor and turn it to untwist it. And that's when the surgical tubing takes over. And that's all the force that ejects the nose cone away from the rocket comes from the surgical tubing. And that's really important now that the parachutes are stored in the nose cone of the rocket. That was the biggest hurdle from the last system, was getting the nose cone off. And then the kepper ring is just for, well, it's partially to keep the twist coupling seated up where it needs to, and then it's also our mounting for all of our electronics and whatnot.
The spacer ring between the kepper ring.
Right. So one of the, probably, and add to it if you want, one of the features that changed the most throughout our design process was where this kepper ring was actually going to sit in relation to like how far up or down in that lower ring. And what ended up happening was we got this machined kind of before it was finalized. We decided not to have these holes in and gave machine the holes later. And then we, to kind of make up for the spacing in between, which I think works out to be a smarter way to do it anyways, is we 3D printed like a ring to sit in between to make that up that gap. But that's weight saving too, so we probably just want to keep it that way. Yeah. So So anybody wanna take over and kinda talk about the criteria that we came up with and kinda why we went through our designs? Or I guess
go through the customer requirements and then the design. We should
yeah,
start with
I was gonna say we
requirements.
Should save this for the other slideshows that we'll show. Because that's when we'll actually get into detail about it. I don't think that this really, the three ring release needs to be explained that much. It's three rings that come apart. So we'll get into more detail later.
Sure. So these were the ones that we had a few more that kind of fluctuated during the process of the capstone, but these were the ones that were most important for us. Obviously, fitting with inside the nose cone is a big one. We have to make sure that everything squishes in there without rubbing against it, make sure that nose cone can release easily. So this was the volume we grabbed from CAD. We're actually right at about half of that, but with that odd tapering, there's a lot of really difficult to utilize space up here. But some of that is going to be taken up by the D-nut and the cords that come down to hold the drogue to the nose cone. For the next requirement was just supporting the dry mass of the rockets. All of the testing that we've done with both of our parachute deployment, and then there's still some further that needs to be done to verify the parachute anchors. But say that we are well in between these, I think we measured it at about 68 kilograms was what we were seeing on our maximum load in our sort of worst case scenario for our parachute deployment. So we should be able to support that even with the larger size of LV4. As lightweight as possible, obviously the lighter weight, the further we go, the easier it is on the engines. Our target was 5 kilograms. We ended up at 6.4 kilograms, which is a little bit heavier, but there's a lot of room for improvement to be made for being able to skeletonize what we have. We just kind of erred on the side of let's make it really robust to make sure that it doesn't break and fall apart. It also helps that we're in a position in the rocket where we can be really heavy since we're putting ballast next to us anyways most of the time. The capable of surviving launch forces didn't really have much to be able to actually verify what that was other than the previous systems and the design of the nose cone make for very little drag. There's not a lot other than making sure that nothing's going to vibrate itself to death. Sort of there, so vibration resistance comes in over in that table, which we'll go over a little bit later. The fully electromechanical portion is in the title of it. We don't want to use any pyrotechnics. We tried to make sure that we're not using any sort of consumable so that everything can just be reset and redone and tested as much as you need. Probably the only thing that's close to a consumable is the surgical tubing because it does degrade over time depending on how it's stored or what kind of conditions it's exposed to. And then for robust, we were asked for a 99.8% successful deployment rate, and we hadn't been able to do enough testing to verify that that's there. But once we got the final system all in its final configuration, fingers crossing ways, we haven't had any problems getting the system to release, so we're on track with that. And our most desired failure mode is drogue deployment at any stage, which at essentially, as long as the nose cone gets released, that should be what happens, so that's what we really focused on. We also wanted to make sure that we actuated within 1 to 3 seconds, because the longer we have free fall, the more likely it is it's going to be difficult to get that off, especially if we're pointed straight down. And our recorded times off of this have an average of 1.15 seconds for actuation, so it's pretty fast. So that's kind of where we are as far as the customer requirements. We'll go over it in our final report. It also has the final details for those numbers and the targets that we were able to hit.
If nobody has anything that they want to add to the kind of quicker overview of the final design, we can start at the beginning of our presentations from Capstone.
I would just add that one of the pieces that still needs to be redone for this to be sort of a truly working prototype, I guess, are two things. There's some shimming that needs to be done because there's a little bit of gaps in some of the materials. And then the spacer ring that we talked about earlier needs to be adjusted for the final height. And it actually ended up being exactly what we had it in CAD, but we didn't have a version of that printed out. But otherwise, we should be.
Other detail that might need to change. I'm not positive the pizza table will survive the acceleration.
Yeah.
And it should probably not be 3D printed, or it definitely shouldn't be an FDM print.
It still needs its final version.
Yeah.
Basically. Yeah. Okay.
Cool. Yeah,
cool.
I think we can move on to
yeah. And I guess maybe last useful tidbit for now is The drogue parachute release is actuated using a linear actuator, so it's just a shaft that moves up and down. And then it's a simple DC motor for the twist coupling.
Okay.
So let's do...
I'd like to have though that DC motor is geared.
Yeah.
It does have a gear box attached to it. Just
no, and that's important because we weren't using the DC motor for speed, and we weren't really doing any other. There's no coupling, you know, to torque it down to, you know, gain torque, and so yeah, we needed the geared motor. Okay. So I'm gonna go kind of quickly through a lot of this.
I think you should. Go
that
over
one.
This slide, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So, again, you can read our project statement, and then Grady just went over, I think these are actually exactly
mm-hmm.
what ended up in our final PDS, so that's really
mm-hmm.
funny. This is a really good example of the initial, like, stage one of deployment, or our system. So this would be after apogee, the peak of your flight, you're going to separate the nose cone from the main body of the rocket. Your drogue parachute deploys, and you hold onto the nose cone with a separate line that's attached to all of this. And then you've got the drogue cup that's in your assembly here that stays tied on. And then the main parachute stays housed in its cup. And the goal is to keep the distance that the cup is from the body of the rocket as like minimal as possible, because if you have too much distance between that main cup and the body of the rocket, you can catch air underneath, and then that would rip open the cup and deploy the parachute early. So this is sort of your first stage. Our expected outcomes were to deploy the drogue and main parachutes without pyrotechnics. This is going to increase the launch efficiency. And our main goal was for LV 3.1 with the future intent that this is a scalable design that can be used for LV 4. And that's one thing that I think we actually did meet, not sort of on purpose, because we definitely stayed focused on LV 3.1. But the designs that we came up with are both things that can so easily be scaled. Nothing about this is limited by weight or size or, in my opinion.
Should only
at
get
least.
Better with
LV4 because
you have more
space. Yeah. Cool. Okay, so this starts the where we started. Anybody want to take over and talk about where we started?
You should just blow through this.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
We started with SMA. We spent a lot of time, let's see, play the first prototypes, integrate.
And who recommended you not do that?
You know, you hated on us always and forever.
Yep.
Well, is this supposed to be four?
Okay, so I think it's worth, I'm going to give a 2 second tidbit about SMA.
Please.
So, shape memory alloy wire. The whole idea behind it, actually, I'm surprised we don't have more.
There's
electronics.
That first slide has our first 3D printed, like, idea.
Which one? This
on
guy?
Other presentation.
Oh, yeah, I just wanted something with the SMA in it,
oh.
though. Yeah. Bummer. One of these we kind of gave an overview. But basically, so shape memory alloy wire works by heating it up. So you'll, like, train it into a position, and you do that by heating it to its, like, its transformation stage. So you go from, I think it's the martensitic to the austenitic transfer, or the phases. And so one is like your shape is locked in, and then when you heat it up so extremely hot, you loosen up the bonds and you can train it into something else or form it, cool it, like you quench it, that locks in the shape. So then you can deform the wire to whatever you want, heat it up, and it's going to go back to that original shape.
Okay.
So it's really neat because it weighs basically nothing. It's so simple. It's a wire that you heat up. You can do that with electronics, and so Nate spent quite a bit of time just like, you know, so you can do like it's resistive heating, and so you just send a current through it, basically. But he spent a lot of time playing with that. The downsides to it were it was it can't pull that much force, and so you could put it in parallel a bunch of times to try and gain a bunch of force. We're talking like it could only pull like a couple pounds. We found one source, I think, that could pull 4 pounds, but
it kind of depended on. So we experimented with two different types of SMA, nitinol wire, which is very much a like you train it into a shape and then you go from there. And then we also worked with flexinol, which I believe is nitinol as well, but it's a compressive force, so it actually just shrinks, and so you get a force per unit length. And with that, we were actually able to lift like a 3 pound weight with a small amount of the wire. So you could theoretically get some good use out of that.
Is this going to be where the linear actuator was? Is that on top?
We were initially thinking of it actually holding on to like a post as part of our twist coupling system, so that it would flex and pull the twist coupling back to actuate it, and it would be a super lightweight actuation method.
We were thinking more of actuation than necessarily what it was actuating. This was early on where we were just trying to decide, is it going to be a motor? Is it going to be something exotic like this?
Yeah, so we were looking at this as a possible actuator.
Without really knowing how it was going to actuate at this point.
Cool, that answers my question.
And I think it's important to mention, too, that if you, if you do, like, if you want to explore SMA, it's super cool in that it doesn't actually fatigue like other materials. It has, I forget what Calvin called it, but there's basically a lifespan where you can train it and like flex it enough to work it enough to, instead of fatiguing, it reaches kind of a plateaued state, and then it won't change its properties from there. So that's a plus for it, but it is a kind of a finicky thing to use, and we just didn't feel like it was going to be super reliable in the end.
Yeah. The biggest concern, I think, that we had was one of the failure modes of it. So I don't think you said it. When we were working with the, there was another capstone team that was actually asked to use SMA for their project. And we went up to work with them one time, and they had like this 6 pound weight. And we had trained a spring, put the weight on it, and went to have it retract. It like kind of tried to pull it up, and it ended up retraining a new shape into it because it was getting hot. And it got so hot that it loosened up, you know what I mean? So it wasn't able, you can end up retraining it. So say our system got a little jammed, it's not like a motor where you can throw more current into it, get more torque. You would throw more current into it, heat it up, which would only
train
like
it to
worsen,
the shape
worsen
it,
yeah.
Yeah.
I think at that point is when we all got really scared of using it.
Yeah, no, that's when we developed the criteria, and that's when we started switching gears.
So what did you switch gears to?
Gears.
Good segue.
Switch two gears. Okay.
Yeah, so let's start with our... this is probably when things got more interesting.
Our slides got better looking, too.
Good job.
Yeah, right?
Also, pro tip for capstone classes, if it's on a big screen, a bright white background sucks to look at, so pick a dark background.
It does, yeah. That's why we switched to the dark green.
I like it.
And peace out colors.
Right. Just don't pull a Parker and put the,
so is
the
this
world background or like the space.
The fake one.
Yeah, as your background for every slide.
Yeah, it's terrible.
It's funny. It's just
like
an ugly green, but at least it's dark.
A few possibilities, right?
Do you guys... do you want to go... you two go over these couple of slides?
Sure.
So this really gets into our initial concept designs.
So this design right here with the ball bearings was in mind of the SMA because of the easy twisting, and that would be on these two posts, rotate.
Andrew,
and
did you
release,
see that?
But people were scared of ball bearings raining down on them.
Understandable.
Another design was the motor would be actuating basically a piece of thread that would screw on and off the top, but there was an issue with
fatal flaw.
Yeah, this part right here was kind of in the way to release any kind of parachute.
So no parachute though.
I will say real quick on this one, just sort of some of the design methodology that went into these. Gabe was working off totally like new concepts. When I came up with this one, was trying to utilize parts that we had on hand from the last system and just trying to see if there's sort of a way to iterate just a little bit better design on what we currently had. And so we were kind of headed down different design directions. But we learned a lot from doing both
of
those.
And then we came up with this guy, which is kind of an iteration of our bearings, man. I told you.
This is a terrible idea.
It was a really good idea. It's
terrible.
It would be cool because it would rain
bearings on literally everybody.
The best part is like realistically,
really
when we did, if when we like went through with that and finalized that design, if we had. Ball bearings would never actually fall out.
Right.
But people, Bert, asked us that question in class, and people kind of took him seriously, too, and were, like, wondering, or looking at us like we hadn't thought that through.
It's actually not, it wouldn't happen, but that's
all right.
We might have been going to school for 4 or 5 years.
Anyway.
But, yeah, so now we're here, and then that moved us to our final design.
Let's see. Okay, perfect, so we can bring up our criteria.
Yeah, so I guess I can talk about that. Basically, what we were sitting down in our meeting, we had a lot of conceptual designs, and we needed a hard way to evaluate things. So this was the criteria that we came up with. Vibration resistance and accidental actuation are kind of related, depending on the design. Vibration resistance was what we put as kind of our most important, since it's what killed the last rocket. And accidental actuation, because we don't want to be on our way up and the nose cone pops off, and I mean maybe parachutes come out, but it just seems real bad while you're accelerating that quickly. after that was simplicity, because the less parts and the easier it is for anyone to be able to pick up an SOP and just put it together and do it is great, because you know, as graduating seniors, not all of us maybe are going to be there as this sort of iterates on and moves forward. And that led into ease of assembly and the use of COTS parts. I think this was winter term, we're realizing we started to be a little bit more under the gun as far as timing went, and the more stuff that you can just buy off the shelf, especially if something breaks, it's easy to replace, you know where to find it, and it's widely available, versus having to like have something machined, and if you only have one of it, and the CAD's not there, or whatever else goes wrong. It's a lot more work to get it back to use. Space savings was a big one, because we have a lot of components that are in a tight space, and definitely one of the complaints that we heard from the previous electromechanical release system was that it was really difficult to tie a lot of the cords and webbing down around the base of the system to get your hands in there to get everything prepped and assembled. And then lightweight, which was important, but as we kind of previously discussed, we're at a spot where we can afford to be a little bit more heavy, so we place a little bit less emphasis on that. So then we weighted those, and then kind of just all discussed these and added our values based on how we felt each of those systems rated, and that's what got us to decide on the twist coupling versus the vertically mounted motor, which was a different design that maybe would have worked, but it had a lot more moving parts and bits in it, which ultimately helped it kind of win out. And definitely the big open center design, which will only improve as you scale to LV4, is nice, because if you need to add more stuff, if you have other parts that maybe need to be housed in there additionally that you don't have room for in another module, it's possible you could also attach it there. You've just got a lot more options that way. So I kind of went over those bits. Basically, big open center design, easy to assemble, lightweight. And then I'll let Marie talk about the drogue parachute.
So these are the first designs for the drogue parachute release portion. It also started with the shape memory alloy wire. I honestly do think that there might come a time where we come back and look at this. The availability of material that has specifications with it is limited, and so that was another reason for us to not continue trying, because we could just run into a dead end. But because to give a little bit of context, the drogue parachute release I took over as my thesis project for the year, and then the nose cone separation was all of ours for the capstone project. And so there was some research that I was doing individually. and I come up with the SMA wire, and then came to the next meeting, and I think Nate was the one who had found sources for SMA wire. So the fact that we both found this on our own, like, and we're finding different devices that we're using it, it just might be worth looking into again. But so this is my first kind of idea with that, and the concept was to combine a socket wrench and the SMA. And so you'd have, if you think about a socket wrench that has like the button on the back that you can depress to release the actual socket, right? So it's got balls on a plunger, or with a plunger inside, that you would put the socket over the end and it would lock in place. And then you would push your button, or you'd push that plunger down, which then your balls can fall into the groove and it releases that sleeve. So what you don't see here is the sleeve. And then there would be a bias spring in this design. And so it would, the idea is it would keep the plunger in place, but it wouldn't be so strong as to overcome the SMA spring when you would heat that up and actuate it. The SMA spring would like pull the plunger in the opposite direction. And then when we switched from that, I came up with the screw and motor version of it, or rather a threaded rod and like a DC motor. And actually that's sort of like, that's really funny. That's sort of like the middle design that was here for the nose cone separation. So same difference, the sleeve on the end would be captured and then that would be attached to the drogue parachute, which would fly away. That was one thing from here to here that I realized too, is a sleeve on this one cannot fly away because the sleeve would be on the bottom. It needs to fly up. So this way we flipped it around. And then, totally just switching gears, and this is what we ended up going with, was this three-ring release design. So, huge advantage of this is that it is something that is currently used by, like, all parachuters. Alan's looked into it even a little bit more and found that, like, not only sports skydivers, which is what you see it popularly as, but also
paratroopers,
thank you. All I could think was parachuters. Paratroopers also use this three-ring release. They use it for their reserve parachutes. So if anything happens to your main, you pull these cords, which is this yellow release cord that you see in the back of the CAD model. You yank that, and that releases the risers, or your cords that are going up to your main parachute, and also simultaneously pulls out your reserve. So same concept here. You are simultaneously letting go of your drogue parachute and pulling out your main.
I just want to say one more thing while we are probably finishing talking about SMA. As you mentioned, I think there's potential for it. If you had a huge budget, one really interesting piece of equipment that we came across was essentially a frangible nut. So it's a couple different parts, and what the, you could have a big threaded rod that's holding onto it. You got a lot of friction and a lot of force holding onto that. And if you had the frangible nut, there's little bits of SMA contained within that that you could actuate and release it. And there's videos of it holding like 1,500 pounds or more. So if you had a huge budget, I try to contact some companies and get them to donate it, but it turns out they don't want to donate like $5,000, $10,000 pieces of equipment. But that exists, so if it ever becomes cheaper.
Quick nut.
Yeah, quick nut.
I love it. It'll be in the resources that we hand over, though.
Good.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. So, same evaluation, three-ring release one. So the three-ring release.
Go back.
Oh, what's that?
Okay, thanks.
Perfect. So I guess this might be a good time to kind of go over again how it works. So you have, well, you guys have the release over there now. Okay.
You want a physical one for demonstration?
Kind of. If we have an extra.
They're all.
Yeah, it's, oh.
Do you want to move on?
Yeah,
just
so it's just, you've got three pieces. You've got your large ring attached to the lower webbing, and then you have these two rings, which are both sewn onto this upper portion. And then you have your yellow release cord that's shown in the back here. And one other part that's kind of in with this is this grommet that's in the back here. And so what you do is you're going to take the middle ring and you pass it through and fold it back over the first one. Oh, perfect.
It's already assembled.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So then you pull, and then you do the same thing with the little one. So you just fold them into each other, And then this is a little nylon loop, just fabric loop that you pass through the top ring and that grommet, and then you pass your release cord through it. And that's initially how it's presented in the original designs and how the parachuting apparatuses are commonly assembled. And then we kind of modified it a little bit to make our own.
Do you want to just pull on this and show
the
cord?
So they're pulling really hard, and for me, it takes nothing. And so that's the big idea here, is that you can put a bunch of weight on either end of that system, like the rocket, and then you can actuate it with just a little bit of force, like the linear actuator. It's sort of the perfect scenario, right? And so how it works is you end up, I'm pretty sure it is 200 to 1. I read back through it again as well. Yeah, so I think the pulley interaction comes from here, right? In this like perfect world, pretty sure it's supposed to be a 200 to 1 mechanical advantage. And how that works is for each of these rings, when you do that passover, you create a lever arm here that is a 10 to 1 reduction. So two of those gives you 100 to 1. And then it's a 2 to 1 pulley interaction. And the pulley interaction comes from the, I think it was the nylon loop that I read. Yeah, going back through that paper, that's where the pulley comes in. And so by the time you get to this release cord in the back, you've done the 100 to 1 force reduction between the two rings, and then you double it with that pulley force. So theoretically, 200 pounds on this thing, it would take you 1 pound to release. What Alan and I tested was, which we tested
pounds.
A lot of times, with an 80-pound concrete weight, it was taking never more than 4 pounds, but usually between 1 and 3 pounds to actuate. So
at various angles.
Yeah, yeah. The minimal, so maybe our like perfect situation, we probably got down to 1 pound, maybe like 0.8.
And how much can that linear motor pull?
It had a stall torque of close to like 15 pounds. And I still want to test the second one that I bought. So the original one, I got a different one that was a little bit faster, and so it doesn't have quite as much power. But the original was, I was measuring like 15, 16 pounds.
Well, the faster one or the original one?
The original. Or okay. So the faster.
So the faster
or
is...
Or slower. Sorry. When you go faster, you don't get as much power.
Right. So is the fast one 15 or the slow one?
The...
Slow one. Okay.
The slow, powerful one is 15 pounds.
Yeah. And it shouldn't have changed too much. I just want to all verify at some point before launch. But it hit that, like, our goal was a factor of 3 for safety. And we more than hit that, so.
That's
cool.
There we go.
Okay, so here's disassembly.
Oh, talk about the grommet and the guides.
So the assembly is literally... the opposite procedure where you take your one ring, you pass the next one through, pass that next one through it, pass your nylon loop through there, and then through the grommet.
And then your yellow release cord goes through there.
Well, the yellow release cord goes through the
orange tie-downs.
It goes through these to keep it
in
position,
line. Yep.
But that's the activation important part. When we first went to make the first prototypes of these, can you go back a slide? They have punched a hole through their system here and put a grommet in it, and I was like not really comfortable with punching a hole through more than half of this, which was going to hold all of the weight. And so I moved I flipped this half of the system around and added this front piece.
I don't know
what
they
did.
It's
in front
of
it.
Yep.
This front piece also, like, when the cord is going through both of them, keeps this flap over the rings so that when the rings pass over the system, it's passing over with the direction of this flap, so it's not catching. Like if it was this way, it could catch.
Ultimately we flip the orientation.
So
picture
parachutists wear these on their risers like that, and we're actually putting it in the rocket this way.
The other purpose for the guides, so I would say in my opinion the most important purpose is the top guide here for preventing accidental actuation. So we'll sew that one so it's like a teensy bit snug. Nothing more than, you know, what your motor can pull, obviously. but just enough to kind of keep it in place for security. This is a steel wire with a Teflon coating, so it's rigid. It shouldn't go anywhere. But this one is more help facilitate travel. The top one is more of a hold it in place so it doesn't accidentally actuate. We did figure out one failure mode, though, which I guess we sort of added to the system by putting that grommet fabric out front. We'll come across the picture later, and I'll point it out then. But basically, it was this beautifully terrible, perfect storm where we had 80 pounds hanging on this, or Alan, you were testing this.
If the length of this nylon loop is... If it's sewn in not the right position or it's a little too long, it can actually catch on the top of that grommet, and I watched it sit and hold 80 pounds just on that little bit of friction between those two pieces like that. Restitching in a different location made that go away.
Okay.
Yeah. The other thing is what I've asked in the final design is that there's a little bit of slack in that fabric there. So I think that what you also saw was it was taut.
It's a little looser and it sits where it wants to sit instead of forcing
it. It was like statics when all your forces equal out.
Yeah.
And that's with just 10 pounds, but it looks the exact same regardless.
You can see that one's quite a bit tighter with the foam too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and this is just all scrap material I just had at home. I just threw that together just to make it work.
Yeah, that wasn't actually one of the ones that got tested.
No, that would not survive our system.
This, I don't think we should show.
This is a really early.
It's just super outdated.
Yeah.
Don't use a giant anchor
hook.
Yeah.
Way too
big.
This is not where it needs to be outside up here.
Yep.
Okay. We did those steps.
Yep. We're good. So these are the three prototypes that Alan made that we tested. So it was I called it the large three ring, the two ring, and the small three ring. The large was supposed to be Bill Booth's original design from that patent. The two ring was Gabe's idea. You don't actually need, you can do as many or as little rings as you want. It's all about force reduction and space. And so that was to see what would happen if we took away one ring from the system.
There are four ring systems on the market.
Okay, yeah, okay. And then there's also this mini force one where they took the middle ring and they made it into two essentially. It's like one circle and then a D shape. And that lengthening that increases your force reduction.
Where did you guys buy those rings?
All of it came from a company called Paragear.
Okay.
The rings, the final webbing, the yellow release cord. It's actually literally called a yellow release cord, and then a white nylon material or whatever.
And Alan, you sewed all this up yourself?
Yeah.
Yep.
It's doable on a home machine. It kind of pushes the limit of what a home machine can do. That's outdoor upholstery thread you would use for patio furniture, like an awning.
Okay.
It is also the thickest thread that you can pass through a home machine needle.
Okay.
Come up, but I did just get a double needle leather sewing machine that was decommissioned from my work, so if we need to do some heavier duty stitching, we may be able to utilize that.
Double needle?
Yeah. You can pull a single needle out if you want to use a single needle stitch, but if you want to have a double needle stitch, then you can do that.
Cool. That's not familiar with the needle.
That's a really nice graph.
We are supposed to give technical writing tips for one of our presentations. You don't want to see that.
Yep.
No. You have lots of clothes that have double needle stitches.
So, next one is Progress 2.
It's just literally
two of them
down at once.
Like two bobbins.
This one
we
might skip a lot of.
Yes.
Just because it's going to be a lot of the same.
Oh, is it? Okay, so it goes down and goes, yeah. Okay.
This is the old system.
There's
one thing that we haven't put a line through the nose cone to the drogue parachute cup yet to do this flip cup. That's one of the last things that kind of needs to get incorporated. It's literally just tying a line to the cup, so it'll be fine. We are going to reuse that Kevlar cord, though. I think it's still a plan, that or just, it could be anything. That line that it's only keeping the nose cone attached to the drogue parachute so it doesn't fall to its death when it's deployed or released.
And which cup is that flipping?
The
paracord? Yeah,
not
the paracord.
Not
the
Kevlar.
because the Kevlar is...
Oh, yeah, that's right, because we did the...
We did some abrasion testing, which you can... We can show the data, but it's in our in the folder. I did some abrasion testing at work, and the Kevlar is really bad when it comes to abrasion testing.
Interesting.
The Kevlar has one benefit when it comes to fabrics. It doesn't burn.
Which we don't care about, because we're not going to like
that. But if you don't care about that, it actually makes it more brittle. And
then so you move to nylon? Okay, that's
that
great.
One is
the regular paracord didn't fray at all.
Just for the record, I'm going to be so happy when we launch this and the whole goddamn rocket doesn't smell like gunpowder.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. Because,
like, Kevlar, you know, you got burning Kevlar and gunpowder and it's a mess and everything and blah, blah, blah. So this will be amazing.
I'd like to know what gunpowder smells like, Andrew. I kind of disagree.
It should only
smell
like burning electronics.
Yeah, that's exactly
not,
right.
Oh, God, that's not pleasant at all.
No. Okay. Oh, and then the small one was just to test mooring. So there you can see, this is our testing apparatus. That's a video, I swear.
Who's
you just don't notice it till the end.
It's mine.
Nice.
Yeah. So I did two main tests that got completed for each of the three ring designs. Was just a straight pull force, which you can see there. And it is just as much as you can, just pulling it straight down. And basically I used a little right here is two hooks and a load cell or strain gauge or whatever you want to call it, for a tensiometer, force measurer. That's I hate it. I hate how many names there are, if you can't tell. But it was, yeah, just a little guy that we used to pull that. Also used that to test the stall torque of the motors, just like attach the string to the end and hold until the motor would move, right? And then doing the angled pull force testing. So one thing that will be interesting for the final design is it's not, we thought for sure that the angle that we were going to be seeing was going to be like out away from the system, but the final assembly has it more at like a side to the system, in and out of the page. So that will affect it some, but the results we'll get to. Go ahead and keep skipping. Oh, perfect.
Cool.
The results from this.
Nice.
Large takes less than the small in the two. When you increase that angle, you increase the force. And then what was also interesting to see was the small and the two, both in the maximum pull force, just standard and the angled, were pretty much the same exact results. There was no math or attempts done to be like, I'm going to make the small three ring half of the two. Or I just bought what was available because they were all standard ring sizes and you just put them in combo with one another. So they'll fall through each other. But more importantly here is that the forces that you are seeing with the angled and the straight, they never go above 4, which is really good to see. Not in theory as low as it should be, but pretty close. And if you actually divide the averages, it's pretty much, this is about a 1-to-1, the small to 2 ring, and then large to small is essentially 2, 1.9. So that was kind of cool to see. And this is what each of the tests looked like. You can just kind of see as an example. A little neat that there's like a little rise on either end, but who cares? That was what it looked like. Go ahead and go to the next one.
Oops.
Just
electronics.
Yeah.
Meh.
Yeah.
Meh.
Since our first.
I'm actually curious about the electronics.
Yeah.
Meh. We'll get there.
Okay, we'll get there.
Yeah.
Yep.
Testing the motor. There's a little video. That was our first 3D print. Well, so this was one that you guys have felt but it doesn't really like to move. That was the first design. And then this guy, I don't know that it's worth passing out actually. It's that and it moves.
Yep. And I guess it's important to note that this was off CAD that we just sort of made up. The final pinion gear and twist coupling are different because figuring out internal spur gear math was a little bit more challenging than we expected, and Premier Gear was nice enough to donate it and basically just be like, we'll just make something that'll work for you.
Yeah. So we got final specs from them.
Yep.
Parachute testing, if you want.
Get some parachute testing. default, been in use for previous piece house, nothing new there.
Did you use rubber bands?
We did.
Okay.
We collected them all after this, I swear.
Good job.
I collected some of them. But the main reason we did this is because we wanted to know what the peak load was on the lines when the parachute deployed. You guys know how the Z-fold works.
These guys don't, so that's good.
It'll be in the parachute SOPs.
Yeah.
You basically like lay the parachute out and like tuck the different gussets.
Are you going to be around to physically teach people how to do this?
Yeah, I'll be around.
Okay, great.
Yeah, we'll be here for this launch.
Okay. Yeah, you like
at least
Alan,
maybe Grady and Nate as well.
Parachute's like a half dome, so you lay it out
unless
flat, you chuck the things in,
too.
You fold it in half, and then you do it like in one third this way, one third the other way, so it's a Z that way.
The whole point is,
and then
no
lengthwise. You zigzag back and forth, making a Z that way.
The whole point is know what?
Entanglement.
Ah, yeah, okay.
So when you do that Z fold, everything is falling. Nothing's over the top of itself. It's all just falling out.
On, like, accordions out.
Same with
right.
the rubber bands, which, if you point it out, you can actually
see
them rubber banded.
There's clusters and, like.
They're at the beginning.
There's these clusters there, and those clusters there. You're basically taking your line and you're. Zigzagging like that, and then you're wrapping a rubber band around it, and then you go a little ways further, and you do that again. You wrap a rubber band around it, and that way, as it's deploying and it's getting pulled on, and the parachute's catching, those little clusters will snap and unravel, and snap and unravel, and you're like distributing the force out over this whole system.
That makes sense.
Go back. Where did you get the little stars?
Magic.
Oh, that's
magic.
Okay.
What he looks
every time
like
I do this.
Yeah.
It's just Alan.
Okay. Yeah.
Here is our big force sensor. It's the exact same thing that we had on the three-ring test, but a
good
big beefy version of it.
Yeah. S-bar is another name for it is an S-bar.
So, yeah, there's some
call it a Z-bar?
Monofilament or fishing line here. I think it was like 50 pound rated, so we looped it around to make about a 200, 250 pound breakaway so that we didn't rip the roof rack off if we exceeded that. Which we broke it once.
Yep. Yeah. At like 150 pound, I think is what it was.
Yeah,
200?
So then we set it up.
It was,
at
200 and it did break right at the knot, so I do think it was more to do with
the
knot than the line itself.
And then we did like a dozen at least. I don't know, I had to come to the bagels and locks thing in the middle.
I think we
upped
it to 300 pounds and it never broke again.
So yeah, this was running into the car, computer was recording all of it, and somebody would hang out and throw the Z-folded parachute out, and
awesome.
It would catch. I think we might have a video.
The Subaru cannot follow the capstone with these assets.
Yeah, under 60 miles an hour, we're just dragging the parachute, so we had to do it really fast. Video of a successful deployment.
Were you literally throwing it out the back or out a window?
Out a window.
Out a window.
Okay.
Come on.
Next time, we need a car with a moonroof or something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that parachute is, the name of it is like a ballistic Mach 2. Those guys say that they have, the parachute manufacturers say that they have actually like deployed that thing and tested it at those levels and higher and never had any issues with this parachute. This is the same parachute that came down in our failed launch and it still looks perfect after all that testing. So
yeah,
like
dragging it on the ground, it like had some scuffs, but it looks fine.
That's awesome.
So peak load was 114 pounds.
At 70.
That's great.
Our fit was 0.6.
Whatever.
Maybe it ramps up crazy right here.
No,
yeah.
It didn't.
What's important is that the force is the same order of magnitude as the weight of the rocket.
Yeah.
So when you start to think about everything that's going on, you go, holy crap, there's a huge energy transfer when the parachute's deployed. You are free falling for upwards of like 4 seconds, and then all of a sudden you have a wall that catches air, right? Well, the reality, that's a simplified version. And then the reality is that there's a whole process to the parachute deploying. And as it's doing that, you're absorbing a lot of the force. And we did not believe that at all for a while. And that's why we ended up doing the parachute testing, was to make ourselves believe that the drogue parachute release system doesn't need to hold like 1,400 pounds or be able to withstand that shock force. That what's really only happening is the parachute takes up a bunch of it, and then you're seeing maybe 150 pounds on your system.
It's actually really good.
Yeah, it made us confident in the hardware that we were buying.
If you do like an energy equation between the two different states, it's terrifying. It's a huge amount of energy that changes, but it goes into the parachute deploying, the parachute's changing shape, it's getting bigger as it deploys, the line absorbs a little bit, all those little bundles absorb a little bit.
We started doing partial differential equations and it was getting really fun. And then it got stuck.
And we also asked, you know, the internet and other people for help. And if you can figure out that math, you can get a PhD. So there's that.
Yeah. Everybody's answer was, and that's one of the things that
the
I think you find.
Like, wow, you're doing that.
Yeah. Or, ha, why are you doing that? You shouldn't be. Just make it robust. That's the answer always. Just make it robust.
Yeah. So our expected peak is 150. We made sure everything in that system was like 1,200 to 1,500.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Back for factor safety of like 10.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's great. We'll take it. Chip it.
Right? Okay, so next is, that final tab.
This one?
Yep.
Why do you have so many presentations? Because you were doing it for Capstone?
Yeah, I just decided that I was going to try to string them together,
Each quarter?
Two or three,
Two or three each quarter.
How come we
three.
Didn't see these for the EFS then?
Because they didn't show them.
Well, I was curious what they did. I meant to ask Julio how it went and what they presented, but...
Yeah, okay.
I think, because this was, we started out...
Yeah, just skip over all the crap.
Yeah.
So that's the
crushed one.
Yeah.
We had more concept development. It's all crap. Don't show it.
This
was like a motor that was
going to
turn.
This is like the final presentation from winter quarter, not the final final. I think
correct,
the final one is kind of final.
It is.
Oh, you guys suck.
present button.
Who needs name?
Oh, yeah, that'll work.
Final old time.
Wait, this was only final final. Didn't you say it was final final final?
Is there another one?
There could be another one.
Final 2.0.
Yep,
you've seen this.
Yep. Go past it. Pass. Yep.
Same requirements.
Skip.
Those were requirements.
I like this.
Project overview.
This is a good example of.
This is the only time I've seen this, so I want to emphasize this point to people, which is when the drogue deploys, the nose cone and the drogue cup are still attached to the rocket. When the main releases, the drogue, the nose cone, and the drogue, sorry, the main cup float away.
I'm realizing the drogue parachute cup is not actually drawn on there.
Yeah, it's not. It should
be. So pretend that,
should
that
be
it is.
Like here as well.
Yeah.
No, here.
Yep, exactly.
Interesting. Okay.
That's a good point. The drogue parachute line holds both the cups and the nose cone.
So at 2,000 feet, and I say feet because that's what it's set at, the we'll have two separate pieces we'll need to recover, which is not a big deal.
Correct.
But just so everybody understands.
They should have pretty close to go.
Just sideways instead of tall.
Wow.
Ta-da!
Efficient use of space. Good job.
Okay.
Yep. Saw that video.
Yep.
Here's our system working.
That was pretty cool.
So this is the new one.
The final parachute cups,
so
and that's why they stick.
There's no parachutes and there's no lines in there, which is why it doesn't have any weight.
So the final one's going to have like a cord that attaches to the drogue cup, that's what it does.
Yeah, you can
part
of the three link systems there, but not the bottom half, holding it down.
And you tie it to where, so this is still proof of concept, it will all work because that line that's going to connect the two will become taut right about like there.
Okay.
That's when you start yanking and throwing your drogue parachute out. And what we'll also do is paste, we have leftover Teflon sheeting from the last system, just really thin Teflon super slippery, that's the whole point. And we're gonna paste that to the insides of the cups probably, at least the drogue parachute cup, because that we saw last year made a big difference in just like the parachute wants to just fall out as opposed to needing force.
Are you using plumber's tape or something different?
It's a Teflon. It's something different.
Are you
the lining to the cup, or are you just like gonna do one layer over the parachute and let it?
We just kind of wrapped the parachute last time.
I think this time.
But there wasn't really a way to keep not us from losing that sheet, and we didn't feel. We punched some holes in it and ran the cord through it,
yeah,
but it just, like, when the rocket destroyed
it,
it just tears
easy.
Super easy. So we probably
like
won't.
With a grommet, it wouldn't hold on the line. Because
I know.
Because that's what they gave us for the model rockets, is just like a Kevlar blanket, basically, with a grommet through it.
Yeah.
So you just feed your chute line,
pretty much.
We can try that.
Oh, I see. That's a good idea. Okay.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
we basically did that without the grommet
okay.
last time. And
okay.
it didn't survive, but the whole rocket didn't survive. So
I'm sorry, one more time jump here. What,
so
just putting
so
a grommet in the fabric.
Teflon sheet with a grommet, so you feed the chute cord.
Oh, literally just
goes,
a sheet, and it just like
goes through it. Yeah, you just
yeah.
once over, so
kinda
it
like
just
a,
opens up. No knots, no folds.
Just an envelope for the.
Yeah.
So it'll be.
Sit in.
It'll have lots of.
Right.
Wobbles. Okay. Yeah.
So I have a couple questions. Is this? Are you guys still more to present?
I don't know. Look through a couple more.
I think that's the only thing that's kind of newish.
Oh,
yeah.
Hey.
So,
yep. That's it.
Okay. Cool.
Okay. Do you want to go back to the overview?
Actually, no, that last one was really good. Good last. Okay. So there's a couple things that we've not really talked about. The first is the what I think you guys were calling the pizza table, which is the gray platform right there.
Alan's pizza table.
Here's a version of it.
Okay. So that won't stand the 20 Gs, and so we have to redo that somehow. And one of the questions I've got is it important that pizza table be removable? Can the pizza table actually be a snowflake?
The pizza table is... easier to
that's
see in the actual
idea.
Module.
Should we...
What do you mean by snowflake?
You need
he's
to be
he's
able to get in
open.
There.
You do.
And when this is inside
yeah,
of the lower
it.
Ring,
yeah.
you've got, like... not even enough space to stick a finger between the pizza table and the outer wall.
Wow.
But
yeah.
setting this up can be done by reaching in.
Yeah.
It can also be all set up onto this ring, and then that ring slid into the other ring and screwed in.
Good. So
we haven't tried doing the assembly that way
okay.
to know if there's anything else that's going to like be in the way, but I think that could be an approach to then make this not a removable piece.
Okay.
It will make it a little bit complicated getting the pinion gear and the twist
oh,
coupling gear.
Oh, wait a minute.
Line
right now, that's above the rotating gear.
I was going to ask, where would you attach your snowflake?
Yeah.
Oh. There's nowhere to attach it.
This right here is where the gear is, and this is to keep any of the lines.
The main purpose of that
there.
Is to protect the electronics.
And the electronics
you have to stick legs down to like
right.
make sure the parachutes don't get all gunked up in there.
We
yeah,
thought about making either not doing an FDM
right?
print, which would be way stronger.
Those, yeah,
right.
and the
we
the
also thought about
be
continuing to print the platform
oh, so
part,
open,
but
down.
Using wooden
yeah.
dowels
the parachutes actually pushing
or metal legs
yeah,
right.
and
right.
just
yeah.
screwing them on there.
So that could
FDM
actually insert
that
into
that
the
like an
cup
a little bit.
Yeah.
Okay.
yeah. Mm-hmm. Use deposition
model. What we want
you
is
mean
SLS,
garbage,
which
no,
is nylon.
Yeah.
Yep.
Where's the cup?
Okay.
Oh,
and
no,
you put legs
the
on it, but there's
the
no reason we need legs. It could be a solid piece
like,
of
okay,
nylon.
So that's
like
the
cup?
Thing
there.
That
sitting
cup.
Okay.
Got
yeah.
It. Yeah, these
could
be solid
it's
all the way
parachute.
Down.
Yeah.
Cover.
I built it so that you would be able to attach the electronics. I didn't know how much like access room the person doing that would need. And there's also a lot of things, screws and nuts, that these legs are like dancing around.
Why do you have a crimp?
I don't honestly remember.
I think we bought that
Did
for
we?
The electronics at the last minute when we were trying to spend money.
Okay, cool.
Okay. we have a good set, so but
well,
you should ask,
have
but that's fine.
Double up.
So
anyway,
yeah, any
okay.
other questions?
Well, we were struggling to
if you guys are going to redo all the electronics,
yeah,
and if they're not even going to be here, which they
right.
don't necessarily need to be,
yep.
then having this access between the legs isn't needed, and these could be like solid walls.
What I'm thinking is that we're going to move the electronics out of that cup,
yeah,
and
put it in the Argus
move it
down
below, yeah, because that makes more sense.
So we need to know are the specs for that motor.
And one thing that's important, or so one advantage of having the electronics above the plate
yeah.
is packaging.
Okay.
Not in terms of how you're putting it together and dealing with it, but literally like how it's all going to ultimately fit together. Where this, and this might be the good time to bring out our actual final system.
Well,
if you want.
I've got a couple other questions before we
well,
move
so
it.
Then real quick.
Yeah.
This linear actuator, your other motor, and both of your mounts for your parachutes
uh-huh.
have to go in here and pass through. And the bat, thank you, and the battery, and that's a big hunk down there.
Okay.
So
unless you're running your electronics off of your own power.
Right, just
oh,
but
our
motor and linear actuator are currently running off of that power.
You will have your own battery. The ERS always has its own battery.
Okay.
So when I yank the living shit out of that yellow cord, we're off to the side. That yellow cord goes straight through that cup, right? And then goes up to the drogue.
Is this
that's
what you're
a
calling
no,
the yellow
no,
cord?
No, the
this
webbing.
Is what you're
the webbing.
Webbing.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
So that goes up through the side and then is eventually attached to the drogue. So when I really yank on that, what is holding the main cup down?
This top ring here. So the slit in here is not big enough for this to go through. So this isn't necessarily all exactly to scale. But just and ever so slightly, but so you would only be able to come up as much as when you hit this ring.
So if I kick off the bottom, then the whole thing just kind of flops out.
There's also going to
be. You're seeing the main parachute accidentally deploying.
Yeah.
There's tension in this based on the length that
uh-huh.
we have here.
Uh-huh.
And then when, I mean, if you were. Static, nothing, no forces on it, you
yeah.
could kick it over, but with the drogue deployed, that's taut. And so you shouldn't be able to
and
knock the...
But
where
so
this
with
line runs through here,
mm-hmm.
we do the two pieces of plastic, we bought a bunch of this like really thick rubber material that we've like jammed on each side of that line. So the cup shouldn't be able to move up and down on this line.
No, and he's thinking... getting like kicked out the side, like your legs coming out from underneath.
Oh,
so my
the blower module comes all the way up to here.
Oh, it's a tight fit. Okay.
Andrew, is
yeah,
it possible?
We'll talk
you're
more.
Asking a different
more
when you actually
it,
see that in real
yeah.
life, you can
I think
pick
I know
it up
question
from
you're
that
asking.
Line.
And
he's
the thing I'm worried about is when you pull on the webbing, the upper webbing,
mm-hmm.
that whole thing stretches. And so the green part, it could come up, the main cup can come up a centimeter or two as you stretch
oh, yeah,
that.
No, this will open
and that's okay.
like this, like a V.
And
but so did the ENSR.
Well, if you're not asking what I think you're asking,
so
then I have a question.
And that's not a problem. Okay, all right.
Yeah.
Because there's a
because you're sitting like, you
oh,
have a little bit of an opening, but you're sitting
the
in that.
The pizza table's not keeping it. In is not keeping it in the rocket. The
pizza
okay.
cable is keeping the parachutes and everything from touching the electronics.
I understand now because the what that's called the lower ring is keeping that now constrained radially.
Yeah.
So you can't kick it out. It might hit the side, but we don't care.
No. That lower ring is up to this area right here, and it's really tight on each side.
Okay.
So there's nowhere for any of that stuff really to go.
Okay.
I got a question.
Yeah.
What happens when you release those three rings and the webbing they're attached to kind of come out a little bit during the process of everything being pulled as a result of that release? Is it possible that could flip out and then create some serious damage as it's coming up that channel? If that makes any sense.
This part flipping out this way or this one flipping this way?
Yeah. After it's detached, after you've detached it, right?
So you've pulled the yellow release
cord. Pulled the
cord,
yellow release
cord.
Yeah.
You want things to catch.
This is just like flopping like this.
Yeah. So my fear is like.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. I don't think that's a problem because
it's
I don't want the zipper
stiff.
All the way up.
It's right. There's not a lot of force though, which is really nice.
Well,
okay.
Like, are you worried that this is going to?
No. We're worried that the top ring, which is
rip straight through the plastic,
is
going to
zipper
up.
Through the
yeah.
plastic. Right.
Yeah.
In particular, because it comes out of that bigger channel that it's in, because it comes it.
Well, that won't do anything. That won't change anything. This being sitting inside of here,
uh-huh.
it's not.
I think it'll
it's just
once we
resting in.
See
or yeah, but just a sec. So this is just kind of inset
mm-hmm.
in there. There's no other purpose to that channel.
Right.
It's right here where, when this goes to pull away and this yellow cord or webbing
mm-hmm.
starts to go up.
Mm-hmm.
This ring is on purpose going to catch right there
yeah.
and pull on the cuff that way.
I guess
and
I'm
you'll see in person that the meat that's there for that, like, that the webbing is going through should be enough to where we don't just, like, break the corner off the cup.
You can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that the way Alan designed this cup is actually the ring can't go past here.
Really?
Yeah, but and what I'm saying is even if you came out of the channel, you would get pulled up to here, and that ring would hit right here and pull the cup off.
Yeah, so what I'm fearful is that, like, in that 4 inches that you have, you've got, like, 180 pounds over 4 inches. Can it accelerate
this
enough to zipper?
No, it can't, because it's not about the acceleration. It's about the force that the main cup will put on that when you finally jam it. And the answer is it's, like, less than a pound. It's a 3D printed cup.
Oh, you're right.
You're
right.
There's
nothing holding
the cup to this part of the system. It's
right. Yeah. No. Okay. You're right. I was other than the friction of the parachutes. I was sitting here using connected to rocket logic for the thing after it's not connected. Yeah. Okay.
Right. And, but for right now, there's no reason to have that big channel like that, right?
No.
It should just sit there.
You want this ring system to pass over these cups without.
You're forgetting that the surgical tubing ring has to be able to fling up over that.
No, sorry. The top channel where we see the yellow webbing, there's no reason to have that.
That yellow webbing could
be
uncovered.
Just lower that.
It could be. It could just
down
come down.
Yes.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
And that would eliminate my non-existent fear anyways.
Right.
So.
That's better. We like that better.
Yeah, a little.
That's not going to make any difference.
It really won't.
Okay.
Yeah, because all
you
would
break
do.
There or it's going to break there if it's going to break.
And what would happen, so what you're not seeing is the geometry of the top of this cup is, like, there's kind of a two-part to it where it domes in and there's a top to it. So you're kind of going through more meat up here than right here. You would just, like...
It'd be a thin wall.
You'd basically be putting a thin wall over this, and that probably would just pop off.
Okay.
Right when you put any force on it.
Okay.
Cool.
So there are reasons.
Want to see the thing do its thing?
Ship it, sure.
Should we
and then
I
have
questions,
because
you're
done.
Really, really cool.
I love
it.
It's
okay.
In the neutral position.
Hello. Okay. All right. So, what are you gonna do right now?
The nose cone off.
So we just have our electronics from the motor directly hooked up to this switch, so that we've got a reverse to lock it and a pop, as we called it. To.
And what's the voltage on the batteries?
This is a 11.1 volt LiPo.
So it's a 12-ish volt LiPo, and it runs the motor with a gear train enough to pop. Okay.
That's awesome.
That's great.
Yeah.
That is really awesome.
Scary,
and I think
great.
That's less surgical tubing than the old system had, right?
We have more.
Okay, before we put it, I'd like to see that reset. Can we see it reset?
We do have to take the arc clamps off, so it'll take a second to.
Oh, because you're going to take the arc clamps off, get the thing all set up, right? I forgot about that.
Back over.
Never mind.
Yep.
I'd like to see it later, but not necessarily.
If you
want to
see this.
What would happen if you ran the motor backwards?
That's how we lock it.
It locks. Okay.
All right.
So.
I understand the reset process, but that's okay.
That gives you an idea of the geometry going on.
Okay.
There.
It would be good to actually film the full reset process. Just see what it looks like.
I'm
going to
take Reggie.
Okay.
Side.
All right, and then can we actuate? Wait. Now I'm confused. This is the lower ring. Where is the part? You said that there is another thing that goes fits over this so it can't kick out on the side.
I thought... Were you talking about the pizza table kicking out?
I think he was confused because I think we had said that there was something...
Yeah, so
right
now I'm
I heard that
dangling
too.
Off like
mm-hmm.
this, right? And right now I have no guarantee that my mane is not just going to slide out and catch the wind and then deploy. It probably won't, but what I was hoping is that there's some way of
even
constraining
like running
this.
This through a hole in the back, so when it pulls, it opens it.
Or something that constrains this, so I don't care if it does this, there's not, we can't do like this, right?
Yeah.
Or something like that.
And you could probably do that with something just as simple as a change to the pizza table, another iteration on that to...
So, like, raising the pizza table so it kind of goes inward and a little...
Or just
little
even
bit.
Having some sort
just
of little retention bits on the outside.
Yeah,
that
like
kind
a lip or outside. Yeah.
Sits in there. It's going to be interesting because this is really what's going to dictate how much of that you...
Is that also making the pizza table
inside.
Even more fragile, though?
Yeah.
Well, you guys are going to have to
It sounds like they're planning on switching materials anyways.
I mean, with the full weight of the rocket, it's probably going to be a lot straighter than this. But
once you have more mass down below.
Yeah, exactly.
But we shouldn't rely on that. So what you guys are claiming right now is that the main will not deploy.
Reset action
setup. Right. Okay. And the problem is you're right. I don't want to make the pizza table long because we're gonna put a lot of force on that, and it's gonna we want it to be able to do this movement around.
So I have kind of a scary idea, which is you mentioned that you still need the flipper. Cable, right?
Mm-hmm.
For one of these.
Yeah, it runs through the drone parachute cover.
Oh, that's for the drone. So you could attach a cable here, and basically get rid of the idea that this is going to separate permanently from the rest of the rocket. Is it critical that the drogue be allowed to go free from the rest of the parachute assembly?
Then you don't have a tube.
What's that?
It changes the whole system.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
No, we don't want to do that. Sure.
That's our product.
Yeah.
Whole project.
Let's not solve this problem right now.
Okay.
Let's pretend for a moment that we've identified an issue that might not actually even be an issue, because if we have, I see what you're trying to do here.
Yeah.
That won't help this issue of that. I expect this to happen. I expect the main to be kind of flopping around, all that kind of stuff. It will partially deploy because I believe the main has to be attached to the rocket, so there'll be another webbing in here, right?
Yeah.
And so it'll be kind of bumbled out, but then we'll just not worry about it.
And I guess that's an important part that we can consider, is that this section right here is where the main webbing will be attached.
Right there.
It's right through here.
Okay.
That's, which isn't, completely 180 degrees from that point, but it will theoretically help.
Yeah.
But I don't know if it will or not, because it's just connected to the parachute.
Okay, good.
When
the three-ring system is triggered, how does the cup kind of deploy?
So there's going to be another line that runs up through here, I believe, that comes up and over, or is it attached inside the...
Comes in one side.
So drogue is out, this is kind of...
It loops through here, and it comes in and out one side, and it also comes out the top.
Okay.
Because the idea is that...
I have to look at the diagram to see...
If I remember right, it attaches here, and it comes up, and it attaches to the D-nut that's on the top of the nose cone. So when the nose cone gets pulled up, it pulls on the bottom of this cup.
Right,
and so flips it up.
I guess I'm asking about the main parachute then.
So this is not the same flip cup.
Okay.
Type idea.
Right. That was my question.
The drogue's deployed. This is like this. It's holding there. And at that point, now we pull the yellow line.
And then it just...
And then
the whole thing
this just
flies
goes up.
Parachute
yep.
stays. It's because it's attached to the rocket.
Yep. Cool.
That's
right.
Yep. And that's what pulls the main up.
Cool.
So I guess this one, we actually don't necessarily want...
We don't want it to be slippery.
Right. We don't want the Teflon on this one. Because we actually want it to stay in. We've got
the
whole
force
of
the
rocket.
Will
yeah.
pull it out.
Yes. Okay.
So that could actually be part of it, is how tight we can pack it in there so that we alleviate some of that.
Yeah, you don't want it to snag, but you want it to just like...
What if we, picturing some sort of, I guess this borders on the line of consumable, but like, I said like paper taped over it or something.
Yeah,
so like
paper
or whatever
tape.
Yeah.
Tape would do it.
That would be fine.
What if you ran a split in the webbing back down to the other side, so when it came off, it still completely disconnects?
But you'd have to connect the webbing.
We don't need to
fix this problem. I don't even think it's a problem necessarily.
Hmm.
So, okay, cool.
Sweet.
So, should we go back through the assembly process?
Yeah, I think I'd love to see this put together.
Did you want to see the bottom of
this?
So I guess that's an important one that we haven't really covered, is
interfacing.
These are our parachute anchors.
The original idea was actually to have kind of a triangular cut into here so that these would be recessed.
We didn't have the tool to do the cuts in the machine shop, so we flattened the other side of this rod is flat across that side, and then we put flat areas in for the nuts to sit.
Mm-hmm. And these are, all these edges are broken so that we shouldn't have anything rough to rub against. But those just will sit in, and the nice part is that this is also rigidly attached to the rest of this module, so it should be nice and beefy.
All the wires come out the bottom, everything connects on
so,
the bottom.
Right, so that's actually what I wanted to see, which is I would like to put all the electronics and the battery on that plate.
Yep, and right now that battery takes up quite a bit of space.
Oh.
And that's the...
That's like 600,000 miles, square miles.
and we do still need some, we were just going to drill... basically, like two more holes to put a zip tie for the battery.
Okay, we'll work on that later. But
yep.
Okay, good. So there's two actuators. There's the main motor,
mm-hmm.
and then there's the
linear
actuator. And the things that's not built into the system right now is any kind of sense on what's happened. So, two questions: do we know the deployed state of the linear actuator, and do we know the rotation of the main of the ring?
I don't know, especially for the linear actuator, since that was a Marie thing.
Mm-hmm.
And
I believe that this linear actuator does have position feedback.
Really?
I think so.
That's convenient.
That's not bad.
Oh wait, how's it sounding?
It's
screwed.
It's got helicoils in the bottoms of the legs, and it's screwed to the plate.
Okay, that's hilarious.
Oh, yeah. All
right, so, there's more stuff there.
Motor mount and linear actuator mount.
I'm just going to take these off so we're not dangling.
That's a good idea. Yeah, the linear actuator has a lot more wires we're not using right now, so okay.
Cool.
That motor doesn't have a feature like that. Perchance does.
It has tachometer feedback, but it's kind of like.
It does?
Tachometer is okay. We can work with that.
Yeah.
I guess so.
Maybe it's our electronic feedback.
So
we're only going to like rotate half or have a rotation. So.
So there.
Or how many rotations? Is
what does the
like 380.
Sorry.
What does the tachometer give you? Do you know?
It does pulses.
Okay, so one per revolution, n number per revolution.
So that is with the gearing a little bit tougher to figure out. But they said 9 per revolution of the motor. So
sure, that's fine.
Do the math to get up to the main shaft.
That's totally fine.
I ran some tests and it's like in the ballpark of 500 per revolution of the main shaft.
And then when you tighten it, do you guys just let it snug all the way up?
We've been trying not to, because one of the problems we ran into with this particular pinion gear
mm-hmm.
is that it's set with a set screw that goes in, and when we run the motor without the gear turning, that set screw has a tendency to kind of back out because it's a soft material, and then you've got a shaft that's just rotating and
that's
not
bad.
Actually
yep.
moving
mm-hmm.
the gear.
That definitely brings up, another thing we wanted to mention for improvements for the next team or whoever's taking this next is drill through that motor shaft or something and put something pinned all the way through it.
Some kind of rigid connection.
Yeah.
Is there any reason we don't just move to a metal gear?
We could do that too.
We could. It's just going to be talking to Premier Gear to get it machined.
Yeah.
And I think the quote that they gave us for getting their tax rebate.
Was that machined in plastic by them?
Yep.
Yeah.
Both this twist coupling and the feeding gear done by Premier Gear.
Well, the gear teeth. Okay.
Yeah. Oh yeah. The
initial
part was by WPP.
Okay. And then so there's two failure modes here, on the ring. The first is that the
twist doesn't happen.
That the motor rotates but the gear doesn't turn. So we can fix that with the pin. And the second is that it starts rotating and then it jams up on the inside against the little nubs jam up against this thing.
And that's like it happened when you were at our table. Is that what you're talking about or something else? When you were at our table during the capstone, you were holding it up and I twisted it and it kind of caught because it was
yeah, that's right.
Is
yeah.
that what you're talking
mm-hmm.
about? Okay.
Right. And so one of the questions is, can we, was there any thought about how we machine these channels so that there would be more of a smooth kick out rather than we hit a wall and have to pull straight out?
I think the biggest issue is this depth.
They actually.
So if you lowered that, you wouldn't have, you could twist as much as you want, it would just fall out. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
the
part
nubs
of that
themselves.
Is that spacer ring,
yeah.
Getting this to sit flush. If you can actually see in the channels, they are filleted down so that once you get to that last bit, it should
kick out.
Slipping out.
Okay.
And we could add a fillet like on that corner.
That's
there.
What I was thinking.
Yeah. Our original design actually had them really gracefully ramping.
Yeah.
But
yes.
We backed out of that because we realized that's a really good way to accidentally.
Yeah.
Actuate
and that was
system.
Part of our lost motion concept was that we wanted
like if
all
the whole
of the
thing
travel,
ramped, it would just want to
yeah.
go that way
then
too much.
If you bumped, then it
oh,
would
I see. I see.
All by
yep.
itself.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we actually switched to just flat channels.
I like the flat channels.
And
I would
have
like
a little round at the end.
I would like that to be a smooth transition out once
yep.
once you've got some.
Absolutely.
It's kind of like we corrected a little too much.
Yeah, that's right.
Yep.
That's
yep.
right.
Help me, because it looks like it has something like that, but it's still jammed.
So the spacer ring that's in there currently is from previous prototype with a different spacing in Z.
It's
if
too
you
short.
Call it that. It's too short.
Yeah.
So we didn't have anything that would fit that in time. My printer broke, and Gabe was busy printing these parachute cups.
Yeah.
And there was like a
help
backlog.
Help me understand
like crazy.
Why the
yeah.
Spacing
always
here matters for that jamming.
So
it keeps that ring from falling
it,
up and down.
Yeah, so right
the
now.
The spacing, I don't think
yeah,
that
I don't
the spacing has much
either.
To do with
yeah.
the problem that Andrew's talking about.
Okay,
I
that's
think
what we were thinking
binding.
Of earlier, as if it was going to bind.
No, it's not binding this way.
Yeah,
yeah.
Where
it's just
where
like
is it
if this was turning,
I don't,
and it
so
caught.
Here's this like when we torque that ring.
Mm-hmm. So he's saying if
channel,
it overturned and just
yeah,
like
right.
here, let's draw it.
And was holding
I can't
it.
Draw
okay.
it. I can show
if
you
if the motor was holding it there.
Yeah. So imagine you've got like
I just don't know that, and this is something that we could do some math on.
So in the corner down there, and this is torquing against it. Then it's torquing, it's pushing the
oh, you've
torque.
Got you've got some friction there? Is that what's going on?
So the other
yeah.
thing I'll say, Andrew, is that when
so
we were actually under tension, that
yeah.
was not a failure mode that we ran into.
I don't doubt it.
Yeah.
It's just like one of those like mm-hmm. really things, like, you know, we jam it on, and for some reason the battery is really well charged.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
you know, we did everything right, and that one time, it binds up right in that corner.
If we
the other thing I would say is that if we put the motor on some sort of timer where at some point it was not powered again,
right.
like I don't, that's kind of how I have a menu right now is run it for a specific amount of time when the motor became unpowered,
right.
I guess it would kind of release that tension.
Why would it bind in that corner?
So what's happening is this is, you see, you have this very flat edge that's straight up
yeah,
on the axial,
yeah.
right?
Mm-hmm.
If you rotate that hard on pinion?
No.
On your pin. The little
yeah.
right.
The
you
nubs.
Rotate it really, really
nubs.
Hard on the nubs. The friction there can actually hold you in place.
Because what we're talking about, though,
but
is
but
like
it's also
time,
challenging.
Because that time when we were there, it was this nose cone being twisted. It was when this is on. This thing actually, like, if it's twisted a little bit like this,
mm-hmm.
then it locks. But if you lower this distance, if this was much shorter and this was much shorter, it could just fall off. There would be no binding because I thought it was between the aluminum that was binding and the nubs. But if you actually change the depth of this, it would alleviate that problem. So
I would be afraid that there that there wouldn't be enough engagement here.
What? But the engagement, all it does is keep these two from twisting off.
Although
from twisting as this twists, that's what this is really doing is like. Yes, it kind of holds some of the stuff together, but...
But not really.
Really, all it's doing is keeping the nose cone from twisting.
Yeah,
with
okay.
coupling.
So it doesn't need a shit ton if it's a tight fit.
Right.
And I will say that the concerns that I'm hearing about really pushing that motor up against that is part of why we went with these materials is that they have such a low coefficient of static friction together.
Yeah.
So I think with the... That you have a huge applied force upwards... You would have to have an enormous force pushing against that wall to overcome that.
Right.
Yeah.
So I think that that's it is a possibility, but I think it's extremely unlikely.
But if we have to remachine this,
yeah.
anyway.
Throw in a fiddle.
Yeah, we throw it. Yeah, we throw in a slant, and we're, and then that's not a problem.
But really, I think that failure mode is based on that, not the twist cuff link in those channels.
It's
that's the most important piece.
Do we have
that
make
sense?
Yeah.
To take
oh, you're saying
so
that
Andrew,
it
the
wouldn't.
Distance,
yeah.
It's not those
like,
nuts.
Buy anything
it's the,
from
it's
Paragear
the, it's the
and
combination
get the free
of how thick this is. Because aluminum binds on itself.
Right. There you go. Yes, that's fine. I understand that.
Okay.
Yeah. Sure.
And it's more apt to bind on itself, and that's why we didn't make that out of aluminum.
Yep.
Because of similar properties. So.
Good. Okay. All right. What else? Should we see you guys reload it?
Sure.
Oh, you're good.
Yeah.
Cool.
Let me grab.
I think we only have two uncuts.
So I guess my big question is, who are we handing this off to? Is anybody on the team going to be around?
So I guess this is just the typical airframe arc clamps. So
how many do you have on there right now?
We just have two arc clamps.
Two, okay.
I like how they're typical.
Well, it's what's all over the rest of the rocket, right?
Yeah.
They're just, I mean,
they're brand new technology.
No, now
it's
typical.
It's a happy feeling when they've
now.
Become standard. Yeah,
LV
exactly.
3.1 standard.
Yeah.
I genuinely like it. I'm sorry. I'm not trying to give you a hard time.
It's okay. I'm not sure why that's a slightly different size.
I am. Okay, he is. But well, it's sort of like the conference room becoming the boat room. It's just amusing.
That's not amusing.
Yeah.
Should
we
try to remove the radio?
Either way, let's do it once we get it on camera.
Marie, what feedback is
there?
Sure.
So
feedback on
the
linear
actuator.
We have position on
line up
the
gear.
The gear
yeah.
With the. Yeah. Let me
I
pull that up.
I agree. I think that's the most straightforward method.
We have feedback
something.
Of some
no,
sort.
We've already got that. Hope so.
Sweet. I know it's got like four or five wires that come out of it. I think it's like potentiometer feedback.
That's fine. But I want to know if it's actually.
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah.
So that releases the ring.
Cool.
You're going to be hanging.
And then, do you need a screwdriver for the pizza table?
Yeah.
Right after this.
Okay.
Can I catch you for
15
minutes?
Exactly.
I don't envy whoever has to edit this video to make it watchable.
I'm sorry, you said you want to
have fun, Gabe.
Assuming somebody's going to edit it.
Good
feel
luck
like
with that, Gabe.
Which I feel like, is that just saying that like, it's probably got position?
Second?
If it's got potentiometer feedback, that's basically saying you would know the position.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that means you.
Well,
yeah.
The question is it the rotation of the motor and the screw, or is it of the linear actuator?
It's got
to
be
the
linear actuator. Up here.
Yeah, right. Well, okay, how about this? It works off of the servo motor library. And I think that's useful.
It does not offer a built-in controller, but does provide an analog position feedback signal.
Yeah, so I think that the servo motor libraries for Arduino are like, you can input your 0 to 225, and that's going to relate to zero stroke to that, what is it called? It starts with a D?
Yeah, good job. Duty cycle.
Thank you. Yeah.
Right. Well, that's okay.
Something.
We'll figure it out.
Duty.
I don't trust that, but we'll figure
does
it out.
Does that not...
Let's get a shot of the side.
But that's
okay. For them, just so you
good
can
idea.
See
it
what
sounds like this is maybe
these motor mounts were SLA printed.
Right.
Right.
This one just screws through the top to attach this motor.
Okay.
And then for the linear actuator, it actually uses embedded nuts, and it's actually designed to kind of squish around it and clamp on to the linear actuator before it gets bolted down.
Okay, that makes sense.
So it's just that clamp force that's holding it there.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's a relatively tight fit even into the aluminum.
Cool.
So the only important thing about this that we've been trying to pay attention to right now is you could add more surgical tubing if you need more
well,
pop force of it.
Sure.
But we're trying to leave this most open channel right now
over where the actuator and the tubing system are,
yeah.
So that when it passes over the cups, you have a gap in the tubing where the three-ring system is.
Right, right.
To help not catch on things. Catching hasn't been an issue, but we thought just to be safe.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So
you can index the two aluminum pieces together,
okay.
But then you have to we have to run the motor to get the knobs to line up internally. So
yeah.
Okay.
Shot down.
Oh, sure.
So the aluminum is indexed, but the plastic ring still needs to be rotated to match with the knobs.
Gotcha. Okay. I mean, yeah, that makes sense. It can be out of the wrong spot.
So where's the candy coming from? Is there candy here available?
What? Oh, there was
some of the Japanese candy somewhere.
Yeah. Check this out. Try this little licorice bit thing. Read what it's called.
And so you can use the lock mechanism to...
Going around
Mark. Or is it drop it setting?
Bitch.
Oh, is this from Lost in Pursuits?
And we got, we just
the pop lock.
We just got caught
on that. You know, I
that was in there.
Yep. About passed down.
Oh, yeah.
So for right now, like through this launch.
Okay, so
you're doing
right now is trying to align it with the nubs. Just a little touch it. There it goes. Cool.
Yep. And then it does help to have someone.
You can actually lock it by hand like that.
Oh, you can hand lock it. Oh, that's nice. Okay.
Or you can use the back motor.
Sure.
But definitely recommend doing it by hand because you can get it all the way there and get your full lock without putting additional torque on the motor. And at least for now, while this pinion gear doesn't have a rigid attachment, this is kind of the recommendation.
Without overtaking.
Yeah.
Yep.
That makes sense.
And so after that, I'm just going to detach this battery.
Okay.
Table goes in.
Back in. This is the three-ring webbing slot. This is the linear actuator slot. And this will be the main parachute webbing slot.
Okay. That goes in. It looks like it just kind of sits there.
Sits there, and then it has screws
on
the bottom.
Like, for a little bit,
that's
I'm going to try to develop my life. Mow the lawn. Turns out weeds take over if you don't do anything. They make friends.
Why do you even
have
the house?
More friends.
Weeds make friends.
She hasn't picked out her RV yet.
You know, that's what's going to happen, right? Is autonomous RVs. We're all going to retire in autonomous RVs.
I would not be.
If it never stops moving, you don't have to pay any rent.
That's right. Yeah. It's going to be amazing.
Just the
except
cost
my wife
of
gets
fuel.
Motion sickness.
Tranquilizers.
I'm fine.
Tranquilizers are fine. Or is he?
That's where they are.
Magnets. How do they work?
You don't need to find junior, senior, student, develop. You need to find freshman, sophomore who can refine and just work with the system and be the lead, be the one who makes sure we have everything launched.
Scaling
you know
it
what
up
I mean?
Was like,
but that's 5 years out.
So what we
well LV4 is we have to have an engine.
What?
Yeah, no,
really?
We don't have to worry about scaling.
Yeah,
well,
no go up without boom boom.
What we do need, though, is we need someone to help us, well, help someone to lead taking the system to get it to flight-ready status. It's,
right,
it's
so that's
prototype
the
prototype status right now. It's not in flight-ready status.
And so Alan and I are both going to be out for 2 weeks after graduation.
Yep.
Like, we both, I think, are going to be back and available the weekend after 4th of July.
Okay.
So no, we'll be back before July.
Okay.
We can rely on you working with the airframe team to take us to the
If it's okay
unless
to wait
I get some amazing job offer in the next few days,
yeah.
But I don't expect. I'll be here.
Good.
This week.
I'll make sure you go.
And then
thanks.
So while we're kind of while the crucial people are here for launch, right? Airframe and recovery is your you can launch or you can't launch teams, right?
Yep.
With where we're at. When do we say go, no go?
It's going to be probably the first week in July.
Okay.
It depends on a lot. It depends. We're not even worried about that yet.
Okay.
Because we don't, you know, we need a new nose cone. We need a fin can. Those are going to come together really fast.
Okay.
In the next couple of weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, right, George? And so, it's suddenly going to become critical in July.
Yeah.
And then we'll probably like
panic.
We do have a pretty early go no go just as far as getting parts manufactured.
Hey, no.
So you're lining that up.
What
that makes sense.
Who did our rings?
Western precision.
Actually, I don't even care who. What is the minimum turnaround time that we can expect for machining parts?
Rings in particular?
Not really.
Actually,
some of them are ring-like.
Launch lugs.
Well, it depends on whether you're asking for a whole new part or if you were
part.
Specifically asking for module rings.
Sorry,
because that's already coded, so that makes a big difference. One of each?
So
well, that part doesn't really matter.
We're out of UT funds. You guys are completely out, right?
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, and I think we actually have all of our parts, too. So we're, like,
good. I think that we'll either use 3D hubs or...
Sure, more or less.
There's a parachute in here right now, and this thing's in here right now.
I guess
you can set that
out. I'm really hopeful since we're designing this really, really cheap local manufacturing. And they can do stuff in a week.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay, what about 3D hubs?
Yep.
3 weeks.
Definitely recommend holding on to this
with your
feet.
With
your
feet.
Yeah.
Pinch
oh,
with
good.
Your feet.
That's
got it.
Have someone
and
hold down the
someone
WPP
holds it.
And then you
like
can stretch that up and over.
And you kind
of
snap this over. Okay.
Try to
yep.
give them a month unless you're going to ask
yeah.
for it as a
and
rent
at this point,
order.
You're
and it's pretty
but
stable.
Then
you're
for
set.
The those module rings, we have that on our
go around.
Now that it's coded.
It's so easy.
That's great.
It's literally, it takes
about 5 minutes. Putting your nose cone on and attaching your
awesome.
Arc clamps again.
So, yeah,
right.
It was the initial 5 to 8
So now you clamp the nose cone onto this kind of base ring here?
So,
yep.
With the clamps. Okay.
And
those
this is the same geometry as the
rest
of the module ring. So.
Cool. That looks really good.
I see.